Hi, let us today discuss about the topic chaotic now. This is the thickest or widest nerve in the body. It has two components, like it has a tibial component and common peroneal component. It arises from the lumbosacral plexus, and the formation of this sciatic nerve is, it consists of two components. These are the tibial component, being derived from L4, L5, S1, S2, S3. So it is taking the root value from L4, L5, S1, S2, S3, the ventral branches of ventral rami of L4, L5, S1, S2, S3 forms the tibial component, and the dorsal branches of ventral rami of L4, L5, S1 and S2 forms the common peroneal component, and both are united as a common trunk and thus forms the sciatic nerve. Is clear? So this sciatic nerve, it is 2 cm in thick, the widest nerve in the body. It forms at the lumbosacral region. Through this, taking these root values L4, L5, S1, S2, S3 is the tibial part of the sciatic nerve, and the common peroneal part is derived from L4, L5, S1 and S2 only. Coming to its course of the sciatic nerve, in this diagram you see, this is the gluteus maximus which like this. So the gluteus maximus is cut. This is the reflected cut end of the upper end, and this is the lower end of the gluteus maximus. This is gluteus medius, this is greater trochanter, this one is ischial tuberosity. These are the tricipital tendon, this is piriformis muscle, and this is our sciatic nerve, like this. And these are the other muscles, like the long head of biceps, short head of biceps, vastus lateralis, semimembranosus, semitendinosus, and likewise. Now coming to the course of the sciatic nerve. From its origin, the nerve descends through this, which is called as the greater sciatic notch. Through this greater sciatic notch, under cover of this muscle, which is the piriformis muscle, beneath the piriformis muscle, it arises out from the greater sciatic notch. It then successfully lies on the dorsal surface of body of ischium. If you see here, this is a greater sciatic notch. This is a dorsal it runs successfully on the dorsal surface of the body of the ischium, being separated only by the nerve to quadratus femoris. So here it is being separated by nerve to quadratus femoris, and under that it is a dorsal surface of the body of the ischium. Then it runs successfully on this muscle, which is the tricipital tendon, which includes superior gamelli, obturator internus and inferior gamelli. All these three together is called tricipital tendon. This nerve lies over it. Then it passes successfully over this quadratus femoris muscle, this one quadrilateral muscle, quadratus femoris, and then on this muscle, which is the adductor magnus. And then it lies over this muscle, which is the adductor magnus. Here, then it is crossed over by, in the successive course, it is crossed over by a muscle which is the long head of the biceps, which is the long head of biceps femoris. It is crossed over by the long head of the biceps femoris. And after that, this sciatic nerve, at the level of the apex of popliteal fossa, or coinciding with the junction between upper 2/3 and lower 1/3 of the back of the thigh, it divides into its two terminal branches. These are the two terminal branches. The straighter one is the tibial nerve, passing straight downwards like that along the back of the leg, and the lateral one, which goes towards the region of the neck of the fibula, which is the common peroneal nerve. Is it clear? So this is the course. Again, I repeat. After its origin, it passes through the greater sciatic foramen, below the piriformis muscle, then runs successfully over the dorsal surface of the body of the ischium, being separated by now to quadratus femoris, then runs over the tricipital tendon, quadratus femoris, adductor magnus. In the angle between the the gluteus maximus and this is a gluteus maximus, which is covering like this, and this is longate of biceps. So in the angle between this maximus and this longate of the biceps, this part of the nerve undergoes a subfascial course and is easily accessible over there. Okay. Then it further descends downwards and finally it divides into two terminal branches. Variation in its termination. Sometimes, instead of these branches arising at the apex of the popliteal fossa, these two branches may arise in the pelvis itself at the origin. In which case, tibial nerve passes beneath the piriformis muscle and common peroneal nerve pierces the piriformis muscle and descends. Okay? Now, branches of sciatic nerve. It gives off muscular branches to muscles, that is the hamstring muscles, which are semitendinosus. This one is the semitendinosus, and this one is semimembranosus. Then adductor magnus, ischial fibers of this adductor magnus, and long head of biceps femoris. All these four muscles are hamstring muscles, and these the muscular branches arising from the sciatic nerve, they arise from the medial aspect of the nerve and supplies these four muscles of hamstrings. Now to short head of femoris. This is a short head of the biceps femoris. The short head of the biceps femoris, it also gives muscular branch to it, which arises from its lateral side. But this short head of biceps femoris is derived from the common peroneal component, that is L4, L5, S1 and S2 only. Whereas this hamstring muscles are supplied by the tibial component, that is L4, L5, S1, S2, S3. These are tibial component. These hamstring muscles are supplied by the tibial part of the sciatic nerve, and short end of the biceps is supplied by the common peroneal part of sciatic nerve. These hamstring muscles are coming from the muscular branches are coming from the medial side of the sciatic nerve. This is coming from the lateral side of the sciatic nerve. Not only these muscular branches, it also gives articular branches to hip joint, number 3, and number 4, the terminal branches. This is tibial nerve, which descends downwards and ends by supplying the region of the back of the leg, that means the flexor compartment of the leg, and supplies the muscles over there, which are 7 in number. The flexor muscles of the leg are 7 in number. All the muscles are supplied by this tibial nerve, and those muscles are gastrocnemius, soleus, plantaris, popliteus, flexor hallucis longus, flexor digitorum longus, and tibialis posterior. Similarly, this common peroneal nerve, which is a lateral terminal branch, descends downwards, and on reaching the neck of the fibula, it gives off superficial branch and deep branch. Superficial branch lies superficially along the lateral aspect and supplies the lateral compartment of the leg, and the deep branch grows in front and supplies the anterior compartment or the extensor compartment of the leg and the related muscles. Okay, this is all about the course and branches of sciatic nerve. Now coming to surface anatomy or topographical anatomy, I'll just say it on the skeleton here. First point you need to take is the midpoint between, this is posterior superior iliac spine, this one is posterior superior iliac spine, and this is ischial tuberosity. You take a midpoint between this and this, that is posterior superior iliac spine and ischial tuberosity, midpoint somewhere here. This is a point number one. Point number two is midpoint between ischial tuberosity and greater trochanter. Point number two, it is midpoint between ischial tuberosity and greater trochanter, somewhere here. First point is somewhere here. Second point is midpoint between these two. Join these two with a convexity downwards and laterally like this. And the third point is junction of upper two-thirds and lower one-third of the back of the thigh. So somewhere here. So join this with this. This represents the course of sciatic nerve on the surface. Okay. Applied aspect. If you see the applied aspect, now applied aspects of the sciatic nerve, injury to the sciatic nerve. If there is an injury to the sciatic nerve, particularly the injury is at a higher level, if there is injury, particularly the injury at a higher level, at the origin, if you see, it results in the paralysis of hamstring muscles, wherein the extension movements of the hip are abolished. It also results in the, it also leads to paralysis of the muscles of the leg, all the compartments of the leg, resulting in foot drop, because all the compartments of the leg are supplied by the common peroneal and tibial part of the sciatic nerve itself, which is a terminal branch of the sciatic nerve. It also leads to loss of cutaneous innervation in the whole of the leg, except those areas which are supplied by saphenous nerve, which is a branch of femoral nerve, that is intact. Okay. Even deep sensory loss, like loss of joint sense or at the ankle, loss of joint sense at the smaller joints of the foot, smaller joints of the toe, all these are lost. It may lead to tropic ulcers at the pressure points, particularly at the heel, and at the bottom of the toes, etc. All this happens if there is an injury to the sciatic nerve at the origin. Sciatica. Sciatica is characterized by sharp burning pain over the along the course and distribution of the sciatic nerve. Characterized by pain in the back, in the buttocks, pain in the back of the thigh, pain along the lateral side of the leg and along the dorsum of the foot. It happens due to compression of the nerve roots forming the sciatic nerve, particularly by the disc prolapse involving the lumbar plexus. Okay, that is sciatica, sharp burning pain along the course and distribution of the sciatic nerve. Sleeping foot. Sleeping foot is a condition wherein the sciatic nerve can be compressed between these two. This is quadratus femoris and this is adductor magnus. At this point between quadratus femoris and this one, this is adductor magnus. This region, at this point, the sciatic nerve may be compressed on a prolonged sitting in a chair. Sometimes that portion may get compressed, resulting in temporary numbness along the region or along the distribution of the sciatic nerve. And that numbness is relieved when the person gets up and taps the foot on the ground for two or three times, and the numbness is lost. It is only a temporary condition, and that condition we call it as the sleeping foot. Intramuscular injections. If you see the gluteal region, dividing into four quadrants, superolateral, superomedial, inferomedial, and inferolateral. So this supralateral quadrant is the preferred region of intramuscular injections involving the gluteus medius muscle. It is safer there. And inferomedial and infralateral quadrants in intramuscular injections are not advised to give because it contains the sciatic nerve within it. So there is a chance of injuring the sciatic nerve. Hence, supralateral quadrant is preferred. Piriformis syndrome. It is an entrapment syndrome where the piriformis muscle sometimes may be larger, particularly in female athletes. So when it is larger, it entraps the sciatic nerve present underneath it and causes pain along the region of the buttock. So that is called as the piriform syndrome. So the penetrating wounds, if the penetrating wounds, if it is superficial penetrating wounds are done along the posterior aspect of the thigh, at the area where the sciatic nerve undergoes subfascial course, that is that the junction of like the angle formed between the long end of the biceps and the gluteus maximus, at the angle between the two, it undergoes subfascial course. It is more superficial there. So a penetrating wound at that region might damage the sciatic nerve. Safety, that means safety in a sense means which part of the sciatic nerve is safer, lateral side or medial side. It is lateral side because less number of muscular branches are involved there, hence the lateral part of the sciatic nerve is considered safer. And posterior dislocation and damage. In the posterior dislocation of the hip, so normally hip dislocation is rare, but posterior dislocation when the hip is flexed and medially rotated, at that point any forceful traction wherein the pull is seen from back, at that time there could be a posterior dislocation which normally damages the sciatic nerve. So in the posterior dislocation of the hip, usually sciatic nerve is quite commonly damaged. This is in brief about the sciatic nerve's applied aspect. Thank you.